First, I didn't even know that San Malo existed. I was on a train going from Princeton, New Jersey to New York City, and I was riding behind a man who was talking on his cell phone. And as we started to go into the city and the train started to go underground, you know, we're going quite fast, his call dropped. And he got very angry. He got kind of ridiculously angry. And I'd just finished a novel and was looking around for a new idea. And I thought to myself, you know, what he's forgetting, but really what we're all forgetting all the time, is that these little devices we use are a miracle. You know, there's a receiver and a transmitter inside of them, and it's no bigger than a deck of cards. You can call somebody in Madagascar or South Africa or France with this thing, even while you're speeding on a train going very quickly. So that night, even that very first night that I started thinking about the book, I wrote down the title, All the Light We Cannot See. And I was thinking in the beginning primarily just about the electromagnetic spectrum and how all the light we can see, which we call color, is just this tiny infinitesimal fraction of all the light that's in the world, all electromagnetic radiation, cosmic rays and microwaves and radio waves. So I wanted to set a book during a time when radio was this powerful and moving technology, when to hear the voice of a stranger in your head was a miracle. But it wasn't until a year later that I came to Étonnant Voyageur, the festival in Saint-Malo, and I still wasn't quite sure. All I knew is I had a blind girl reading a story to a boy over a radio, and I was walking through the city one day with my editor. And I said all the foolish American things, like, look how old this city is. Everything is so old and medieval. And he said to me, you know, this city was 86% destroyed in August of 1944 by Allied bombs and artillery. And that's when I started thinking, you know, about memory and reconstruction. Then I learned that this is an amazing place to receive radio transmissions from England. That's a great place to broadcast from. So the more I read about the history of Saint-Malo, I started thinking, what if I tried to set my book about radio here in this amazing town? I also had a protagonist, a young girl who's in love with the sea. So I thought, you know, this could be a place she could explore marine biology. When I first came here, I thought Brittany was in Great Britain. That's how foolish I was. I didn't even know. So I had to learn all about the history of the fortifications of the Atlantic Wall and the occupation. And as soon as you start reading about 1944, you need to go back to 1940 and understand the invasion of Paris. And really, you start to have to start reading about World War I and how all the seeds of the Second World War were planted at the end of the First War. So, the book took me 10 years, and primarily because I was reading a lot. Eventually, I just decided on this blind French girl who would leave Paris and spend out the years of the war in Saint-Malo. And her counterpoint in the novel is a German boy, and whose name is Werner, and he's quite gifted with radio and electrical engineering. And it takes almost the whole novel for their paths to intersect. It's a book with no American characters in it, and it has very, very short chapters that move back and forth. So it can maybe feel to a reader like a tennis match, where her attention is moving back and forth between the characters. And there's a lot of focus on birds and science and the natural world. So I thought all three of those things would mean nobody would ever read it, you know? And the two characters only get to be together for a few hours. And, it's not a typical love story by any means. And so I just assumed all of those things would work against the book commercially. So I have been deeply surprised and, of course, honored to reach so many more readers with this book. But I'm not exactly sure why. In my book, I tried to ask questions about radio. How was radio used as a tool of resistance, but also as a tool of propaganda to get people to be violent? In many ways, maybe the rise of Nazism would have been impossible without radio. And so one way the world is changing so quickly is through digital media and the internet. And so I wonder how the Islamic State is using Twitter, YouTube in particular, to motivate young, disenfranchised men to violence. But also how the internet is this amazing educational tool. You can live in extremely rural Canada, say, or remote parts of France, and you can learn English from YouTube, or you can learn trigonometry from YouTube, you know? So the internet is a miracle, and it's being used in both dangerous and really important ways, and those questions just fascinate me. When I was coming up as a writer in my early 20s, I discovered this very, very thick anthology of short stories called The Story and Its Writer, and it contains about 120 different short stories by all these different writers around the world. But I understand that that's a little bit of a cop-out. So if I could just bring one novel, I would bring Moby Dick. Always been important to me as kind of a touchstone. You know, I read it in high school, but didn't like it. It didn't compel me. There was too much technical information about whaling. Then I read it in my 20s and fell in love with it. You know, it's an adventure story. It's mythical. It's about the ocean. It's about history. And it's funny. But then, you know, you read it again in your 30s and you see even more. And I think that's what really truly defines a good work of art in any field, literature or music or opera or film, is that it endures and then it's reliably moving each time you go back to it, so that the work stays the same. But as you age, you can see new things as you grow as a human being. And so finding a book like that that rewards multiple rereadings is a wonderful thing.